7. By faith, are you with me? Are you with me? By faith, verse 7. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, you see, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By faith, Noah, being warned about things not yet seen, hindi pa nakikita. Noah hasn't even seen a rain in his lifetime. But the angel of the Lord told him that there will be a big flood. Things not yet seen. But Noah, by faith, believed. And he was able to build an ark. Do we have a faith like Noah? Who can do something, who can do an extraordinary things before God? If you have faith, you can hear, you can read a lot of people who are doing extraordinary things for God. Why? The answer is, that's faith. They have faith. They're obeying God. They're willing to do what God asks them to do. Now, if you have faith, you can do the same thing. God would ask you something. It may be big. It may be small at the start. But if you don't believe in God, you won't be able to do that. You are just like a seed is sprouting and then die. You won't be able to grow. Because faith will enable us to build something better. Amen?
Amen.
Do you want to build something better? Amen. For God. Amen. Verse 8. By faith, again, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went. Wow. So by faith, you can be an adventure. It's an adventure. You can go a different. You can go to different places. Some people say, "No, I cannot leave my family." But have you ever asked those missionaries who goes to? They chose to go to and live in the mountains and live the comfort of their homes, the comfort of their air-conditioned houses and soft beds at night. Why? That's faith. Because faith will enable you to go to different places for God. Without faith, you cannot be a missionary. Without faith, you cannot reach out even to your seatmates, even to your workmates, even to your family. Because you lack the faith in God. So if you will ask yourself, why am I not reaching out to other people? Ask your faith. How's your faith right now? Because God is not hindering us to do bigger things for Him. Everything is laid out as long as we're going to obey Him. So this is faith. Do we have this kind of faith right now? We can ask ourselves. Okay. Verse 10. There are loads of people here in chapter 11. I'm just picking up some of it. So verse 10, and I forgot. 11. By faith, Abraham, that's Abraham again. By faith, faith blesses. Do you know that by faith, he blesses his children. You can bless, you can transfer your blessings from you as a parent to your children. You can bless your siblings. You can bless your parents. You can bless your family. Because by faith, you know that what you are receiving is possible for them to receive as long as they will accept Jesus Christ. And that will not stop you. Sometimes you will say, if only they are a Christian, if only they believe in God, they will not suffer this and that. Why are you not sharing? Because you don't have that faith. But if you have faith, you can do such things, so many things that God will enable us to do. So now, can you see a little bit? Can you picture what faith is required by God from us and what kind of faith we need to have in us. Do you envision this? Faith at first is like a seed that is implanted to our hearts. But once it has grown, it will become like a tree that will bear much fruits in our lives. So don't withhold the faith that is in you right now. Let it go, grow deeper, rooted in the Word of God, and higher so that people will see the fruits of it. Amen? Amen. Now, you might think that, well, I have this faith. I am learning, I'm on the discipleship lessons, but there are times, here comes the problem. When the time comes, when there are troubles, when there are problems, we are easily shaken. Okay, sometimes we thought, by the theory, we're reading the Bible, yes, it's easy, yes, yes, Lord, you are like this, yes, Lord, you are a mighty God, yes, Lord, you conquer the grave. We are singing that. But when trouble comes, we easily forget God. And our faith breaks down. Right. Have you heard, I've read an illustration. There is a Christian. He was walking by the cliff. Oh, I forgot to take the picture there. He was walking by the cliff and he was like really amazed for the wondrous work of God. He said, Lord, this is so beautiful. Lord, you are so amazing. Oh, look at the hill over there. Look at the ocean. Look at the cliff. And then he slipped. And he fell off the cliff. Good thing there is a branch of a tree that is like outside. And so he managed to touch himself and he was like hanging there. But the cliff is like still halfway. So he was shouting, Lord! Lord, please help me! Lord, please help me! And suddenly, the voice of God was very loud and clear. Let's say his name is Jason. Jason, do you believe me? Do you believe in me that I can save you? Yes, Lord, I'm a good Christian. Lord, I have a big faith. Okay, Jason, if you believe in me, let go of that branch. What, Lord? Lord, can you please repeat it again? Because he was thinking that the angel of God will just come and hold him and put him up. Lord, can you? It's a little bit choppy here. I couldn't hear your voice clearly. Can you please repeat it again? God said, Jason, let go of that branch. And then he had a big sigh. He said, okay. Is there somebody up there? Can you just give me a rope? This is what happens to us. Sometimes we're saying, Lord, Lord, please help me. And when God gives you something or instructs you to do, I have another plan. I have a plan B. I don't want what God is telling me to do. I don't like it. Is that faith? Where is our faith rooted? Okay? Don't go and look for a rope when God himself, he didn't even realize that it's only like 2 feet and he's already in the ground. That's why God is just telling him, let go and you will just drop. It's very close to the ground. You see? It's easy. God said, it's so easy. Just let go of that in your hand. The ground is there already. But because our focus is on the problem, we forget about God. And we don't want to listen to his voice. Alright, so, sometimes you may say, well, these are the teachings, theory, blah, blah, blah. But sometimes when putting it into practice is difficult. So let's go to the people, like in the New Testament age. Okay? To make it even more real. Jesus spent 3 years discipling his disciples, teaching, doing miracles. They were all there. Just imagine yourself, you are one of the 12 disciples. Every day you are with Jesus. In Matthew, we will find there that Jesus is feeding the 5,000. Jesus is feeding. Jesus is healing the sick, driving out demons. So the disciples were there firsthand, witnessing what God can do. I think, let's go to Matthew. We will see there that the disciples, as we have in our lesson earlier on, they are learners, and Jesus is teaching them. In Matthew 10, Jesus sends the 12 and giving them the authority. If I will read it in Matthew 10, verse 1, he called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority. God has given them the authority to use his name. What? For what? To drive out evil spirits, to heal every disease and sickness. So you have the authority. We, all of us Christians, was given this kind of authority. Amen. To drive out demons, to heal the sick. So this is in Matthew chapter 10. But come to the nearly end of his career, Jesus, you know the transfiguration? Before the transfiguration, I think I've got slides there enough. Matthew 17. So, in Matthew 17, we will see there in verse 1 that Jesus took the best of the three of the disciples, the people who are close to him. It's Peter, James, and John. And they went to this mountain and they spent the night there praying. And there the transfiguration happened. Down below, left, were the rest of the disciples. Imagine that three of you and pastor went out for a conference like now, like today. Pastor, Brother Manny, the youth leader, went out. And we were left here. What happened to the disciples is like this. So they are the one doing the ministry. There is a dad whose son is having seizures. And he went to the disciples and saying probably, oh, please help my son, he's having seizures. He's probably demon possessed. Can you please lay your hands and drive out the evil spirit? As you can imagine, probably the disciples are saying, wow, this is our chance. We can do what Jesus is doing. He has given us the authority. So probably they prayed, okay. They're praying, okay, please, demon, go away. Heal, be healed. But nothing happened. What happened, they said. So I don't know what the chaos was there, because probably it is a shame. They are disciples of Jesus. And now they cannot heal this boy with sickness. Just imagine, there are lots of crowds. Just earlier on, previous days, God was doing all types of miracles. Healing the people with sickness, even raising the dead. And now there's a boy, they cannot do what Jesus is doing. Okay, so here comes Jesus and the three disciples came down from the mountain. And that man, that father, saw what happened. And we can read it in verse 15, 14. Sorry, I don't have So Matthew 17, verse 14. When they came to the crowd, a man approached Jesus and knelt before him. Lord, have mercy on my son, he said. He has seizures and is suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not heal him. What a shame, isn't it? If people will say now, Pastor Benny, your disciples, they were out, they're drunk. What a shame. Imagine what probably came into Jesus' mind. Ah! Something like that, or I don't know, probably Jesus. But you can see here, what Jesus said in verse 11. Oh, unbelieving and perverse generation. Jesus replied, why? Because they've been under the teaching of Jesus for nearly 3 years now. Jesus means he's nearly finishing. Probably Jesus is saying, it's already 3 years. Until now you haven't learned the lesson. So Jesus is saying, how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy here to me. Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of the boy, and he was healed from that moment. So what went wrong? So probably the disciples who were ashamed, and probably they were saying, ooh, nakakahiya naman kay Jesus, ni natin napagaling. Or probably, look what happened to us. It's a shame to our teacher. We couldn't put in application what he has taught us. Imagine that. So, it says here in verse 19, then the disciples came to Jesus in private. Nahihiya sila. They were ashamed. And asked, why couldn't we drive it out? Probably they were saying, Jesus, what's your secret? Or probably, if they're humble, Jesus, what have we done wrong? Or probably, Jesus, can you please teach us? But this is Jesus' answer. He replied, very simple, because you have so little faith. So, it boils down to what? Faith. Driving out demons, praying for the sick, is not about our ability. It boils down to our faith. Remember, we have talked about what faith can do earlier. So our faith in God can accomplish things if it is faith that is anchored on what Jesus can do. Amen? So sometimes you will think, I prayed for this, but it didn't happen. Probably the reason is your faith. So, Jesus said, I tell you the truth. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. Have you heard about this verse? The faith as small as a mustard seed can accomplish things, something like that. You've heard this before. But actually, this is a figurative speech. It is not about the size of your faith. I heard, well, from in the Philippines, I always hear people saying that, oh, you know what? This sister, blah, blah, blah. Oh, malalim na siya sa pananampalataya. Or, oh, this sister, she has a strong faith. Or sometimes, oh, sister, can you please pray for me? Because I know you have a big faith, di ba? Sometimes we see people, we look at people, the length of time they are in the church. Sometimes we think that the longer they are in the church, the knowledgeable they are, they have bigger faith. And sometimes we look up to them. But we forget, this is not about the size of our faith. Jesus wanted to rebuke the disciples that, what have you done? It's been 3 years. It is not about the size of our faith, but it is the defectiveness of our faith. Your faith is defective. It's probably you are thinking about, oh, I'm good. I am a leader in our church. Okay, let's pray. Blah, blah, blah. You are very eloquent. You can pray very beautifully with, say, beautiful words. But faith is not about that. If faith is about God, it is not about us. Remember this. Faith is about God. It is not about us. Where does your faith anchors? The reason why they cannot drive out demons, even though they are saying that, in the name of Jesus, go away. But how do you see Jesus? This moment. But if you say, in the name of my great God, who can divide the sea, in the name of Jesus, of my God, who died on the cross, in the name of my God, who can raise the dead,